Shall we start now?
Yes, we can start, sir.
Okay. Very good afternoon and good evening to all of you. And on behalf of Cancer Biology Cluster and with the blessings of Honorable Founder President, sir, Honorable Chancellor, sir, and Honorable Vice Chancellor, ma'am. Under the guidance of respected Selvamurthy sir, respected Dr. B.C. Das sir, under the umbrella of Cancer Biology Cluster, last month we had started a webinar series. And so this is the second webinar series of Cancer Biology Cluster. So on behalf of Amity University and the Cancer Biology Cluster, I welcome all of you. So before I introduce our today's speaker, Dr. Professor Arvind Savra from MIT University, Haryana, may I kindly request Dr. B.C. Das sir to say a few words about Cancer Biology Cluster and about cancer immunology, because sir is a big expert, is a father of HPV in India, which is a cancer immunology part. And so may I kindly request sir to say a few words.
Yeah, thank you Dr. Dhruv. It was nice that as Dr. Dhruv has said that first of all the cancer cluster, so this is I think one of the first cluster which was developed, and it is with the kind vision and advice and initiative and the inspiration from our none other than our Honorable Founder President Dr. Ashok K. Chauhan. He comes out with the something innovative, something new things which he often do not think of. So it's a great visionary. So with that we have at least I think 8 clusters in at present in the in existence. There are artificial intelligence, there is coronavirus, there is public health, and I think there are several. And then another most important is the neurospine cluster. So there are several clusters. I do not remember all the, but there are 8 clusters. And and also Dr. Selvamurthy was one of the protagonists and who also has helped to establish this, taken full initiative to establish these clusters. First among the Amity family, and then later it will be propagated among others also. We can invite from the national and international level people to become member, and then it becomes has a greater importance in a specialized subject, which is whether it is a neuroscience or a neurospine cluster, or it is a public health, or it is artificial intelligence, or it's a cancer. So these are the frontier areas where we need to make people aware, as well as there are a lot more things we can do after joining hands. There are variety of faculties, scientists and specialists in these fields. And even within the specific subjects, specialist subject, there is also super speciality. So one person in cancer cannot do everything on the cancer. For example, today's is a cancer, one of the aspects which is generally not very looked upon, but people are very aware that the immunology, one of the important aspects of the cancer biology. But if you search for the cancer immunologist in India, you cannot give any, at least I have so much, 40, 45 years of experience. I can rarely take somebody as a really cancer immunologist. But somebody might be doing something or the other. But it's an important subject in cancer biology that, as you know, when the standard treatment of radiation, chemotherapy, radiotherapy, and surgery when it doesn't help, then it comes the rescue, the immunotherapy. Though they are very costly, but it is not the cost. It is nothing more than cost of a life of a human. So it is important that how can we save the persons. So there is immunotherapy that has come in the big rescue, but there are huge amount of research to be done. And immunology, or that, as you know, it starts from the clonal development or a cancer originates. There are oncogene, tumor suppressor gene, and many things in molecular level we do. But even if you do that, the cancer cells generally overcome the cancer, the immune surveillance. So that how that they come out of the, or they escape the immune surveillance and they cause the cancer, that's very important things to look into. And the biology of this, immune biology of the cancer cells, and how they communicate, and how the immune molecules communicate each other, and how they escape the treatment and cancer relapse. That the major point or important is the cancer relapse, and that is the major aspects the cancer biologist and the cancer clinicians are looking into, how to overcome this drug resistance and to prohibit or come out of the cancer relapse and the recurrent cancer that occurs. And that leads to the, and once it is recurred, then it is become very aggressive and the distant metastasis, and that time no therapy works. So this is what we know, and this is the aspect today. Dr. Arvind Savra, who has and you will know for the introduction, he has a really excellent career in abroad and has experienced persons in this field. We need a lot of specialists in this field in India to work on the really immune aspects of the, or immune therapy to immune surveillance and the immune response when in the cancer patient, the cancer immunologist. So we can call him as a cancer immunologist, and we look forward to his excellent talk, what he would be able to speak to with us. We will be knowledgeable in that. We know we do our study or cancer research in our specific area of research we do, but there are rare personality in the field of cancer immunology that we have today. In the second lecture, I think first lecture, the coordinator, Dr. Dhruv Kumar, has delivered. And then this is the second lecture. Maybe that we have to do very frequent lectures, and we can not only restricted to the whether a member or not, suddenly they will be, once they are invited to become deliver the lecture, they are automatically will be member with the family members, and they will be happy to be member. So we will not only national, now within the family, with the Amity family, then we'll go out of family sometime, and that may be India or abroad. So that is what my suggestion would be, so that we need to know what is new, what is the, at the present context, the question is what is new. We should be knowledgeable with that. So accordingly, all this field of the cancer biology, so that we can direct our research accordingly. We can join hands to do some new research. We can be any part of the world or anywhere. We can collaborate for a national project, international projects, or in-house projects, wherever it may be. We can join hands. One cannot be specialist or a expert in all aspects. So I will not take much time. So I would thank you very much, Dr. Dhruv, for inviting me to have a introductory remarks. So thanks, Dr. Arvind Savra, for agreeing to deliver this lecture. Thank you. We look forward to your lecture to learn more about cancer immunology. Thank you.
Sir, thank you very much for your introductory remarks. And sir, it's a very well taken your the message that you have conveyed. And since we have just started, this is our second webinar. So in future, we will invite all national, international the speakers from you know the other part of the world to deliver and you know the lecture in this webinar series. And so sir, thank you again for your introductory remarks. Now I would like to introduce our today's speaker, Professor Arvind Sabra. Professor Arvind has done his PhD from CDRI in 2001. CDRI, we all know that it's a premier institute of CSIR, and it's mainly based on the drug discovery, the drug discovery institute. So people mainly work on you know the drug discovery project. After completion of his PhD from CDRI, he went to USA and he joined as a postdoctoral fellow at the Department of Medicine, University of Connecticut. And in 2008, Dr. Arvind has joined the same institute as an assistant professor. He continued as assistant professor till 2017. And then in 2018, June, he joined as a professor and director of Stem Cell Institute at Amity University, Gurugram. And since then, he is continuing as a professor and director of that Stem Cell Institute. Dr. Arvind has done extensive work in the area of infectious disease, in the area of stem cell research, and also oncology and in cancer immunology. So in the today's, you know, the lecture, he will be, you know, discussing about the recent trends of cancer immunology and how this escape, immune escape mechanism works. Dr. Arvind has received several international and national awards, including Overseas Fellows, Royal Society of Medicine, London, UK. He has also received Federation of Clinical Immunology Society Travel Award. So there are several other awards are listed in his CV. Dr. Arvind has published around 40 research articles and book chapters related to stem cell, cancer immunology, and infectious disease. He is also a reviewer and editorial members of several reputed journals, including Scientific Reports and other stem cell related journals. Dr. Arvind has received several research grants, mainly funded by NIH, around $0.1 million as a principal investigator. And he has contributed hugely in the field of stem cell as well as in the area of cancer immunology. So with this, I welcome Dr. Arvind to share his thoughts, views, and his research on the cancer, the immune escape mechanism. So Dr. Arvind, please.
Thank you, Dr. Dhruv, and thank you, Dr. Das. Like, it is really an honor to present some of my work and some of my thoughts in front of means scientists of your caliber, sir. Like, it has been an honor, like, to meet you a couple of times and share some of the thoughts. And I look forward to working more closely with you and learn from your experience and build some of the innovative approaches that India very badly needs to help our society to combat cancer with the approaches like immunotherapy, which do not have a side effect of radiation or a chemotherapy. And I really am very much appreciative of this cross-campus initiative in the form of this cluster that has been formed and spearheaded by Dhruv. So I thank you for making me part of this. The basic objective for this talk that I have envisioned is like I'm going to showcase some of the challenges that the field faces and some of the approaches that we have been working on over the years and some of the recent approaches that I've picked up even after coming here. The basic objective is like so that I can showcase some of my expertise, skills, resources, and then this will open up a platform for more collaborations and more exciting work along the line. So before I start, like I must also thank our leadership at AUH and the leadership at Amity Group. Like I'm really thankful for our Vice Chancellor, Dr. P.P. Sharma, our pro vice chancellor Dr. Padmakali Banerjee, and more than that, like our honorable chancellor, like whom I had the opportunity to discuss at length some of the thoughts that I wanted to do, and he invited me to join MIT University Haryana. And over the last 2 years, like it has been a real pleasure to see how close-knit family MIT is, where everybody is welcome to share their thoughts and like go as much as they want and as much as they are capable of, and the sky is the limit. So we just had our innovation day like yesterday, and we showcased some of the recent innovation that we have made. I'll be sharing some of that work also in there towards the end. But I look forward to more exciting work along with more and more colleagues. So with that, let me just start by sharing my slide. I hope it is visible, Dhruv, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it is visible, sir.
Yeah. So let me see if it works on the full screen. Otherwise, I'll just go it in this way because the slides are number is
so
more.
If so you can make it as a full screen, yeah. If you can press simply F5, yeah. I think it should work.
All right. Yes. So basically, like as I said, like I think the slide will give problem in this mode because there are number of slides. This file is a little bit larger. So, but let me see, like if this movement of the slide doesn't get hampered. Otherwise, I'll just go in that mode. Like I hope you won't mind that.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Let's just. Everybody just bear with us for a second and I think we will be in a presentation mode soon. So a little bit background, like I think since this audience is from a different areas of cancer research, so I will be talking about like some of the how the cancer develops, what are the major features of the cancer initiation and its development, and later on like how immune system, which is responsible for protecting us from okay, I will have to probably restart it, like hold on, guys, bear with me, guys. So basically the our immune system is capable of protecting us against all the infectious diseases, because like all the vaccines against different infectious diseases, but we don't get polio anymore. We don't get chickenpox anymore.
PPT is gone. Excuse me.
That's what I was saying. Like I will have to reopen it. So it is reopening. In the meantime, I'm just keeping people interested with my talks, and then I'll be sharing the slide in a second again. So because this file is a little bit larger, so that's why like in a full mode, I was facing problem.
I think you can go ahead with this mode, sir. Yes,
yeah.
Fine. Yes, sir.
Okay. So when we talk about cancer, like cancer is a large family of disease that involves abnormal cell growth with the potential to invade or spread to other parts of the body. And there are like some benign growth also. So you don't get that spread to different tissues, and they don't threaten us. But like what is unique about this cancer, which is life-threatening, that it has a metastatic ability. And once it has reached to the metastatic state, then a person's life can also be threatened. And like, although the cancer is one single term, but there are many different types of cancer. There are more than 100 types of cancer that can affect human health. And as we see, like with the changing lifestyle, with the changing environmental conditions, like more and more cases of cancer are appearing over in India also. So means there is a need for developing effective therapies, whether it is immune checkpoint therapy, whether it's cancer vaccines, or whether this is adaptive immunotherapy, in addition to like our pharmacological drug mediated intervention. So when we talk about cancer, like what are the significant features of cancer? So all the cancers, one of the basic properties, they acquire like enormous growth potential. They're self-sufficient in growth signals. They are insensitive to anti-growth. So usually in our body, like whenever a cell develops, this has a finite life. So our blood cells, they have a finite life, and then our hematopoietic stem cells, they generate a newer blood cell population. But when we are talking about tumor cells, like this control of our life cycle of our cells, that is lost. So once this cell become immortalized, then it starts growing and they form a tumor mass. And then the mass needs to grow. So they need to have blood supply also. So the angiogenesis is needed. And once they are growing, in order to like move to other paths, means tissues and body parts, they acquire the ability to invade these means different parts of our body. And essentially, like as means they acquire growth potential, they become insensitive to anti-growth signals. They also become insensitive to cell death signals. Usually, like means as I was saying, like there is a finite programmed cell death, which is means. Essential part of our human physiology, but these tumor cells, they become insensitive or to all these apoptotic signals. So these are some of the salient features of a cell which has transformed into cancer cell. So now what I was talking is like our immune system is there. And when we get a vaccine against any infectious disease, we are protected. But why is our immune system not able to protect us against cancer? So there are some of the inherent challenges and also some of the means mechanisms that developing tumor acquires. So there is a hypothesis that even the immune system is selecting a very highly malignant tumor, but that's a means a hypothesis in a sense, like most of the immunogenic tumor is getting deleted and then the non-immunogenic will be sustaining, but like how it happens. So usually like our immune cells are T cells or B cells. And our innate cells also, when they see a danger, they attack the foreign pathogen. Our macrophages are there, like as soon as the bacteria or a virus reaches, they are there to take care of it, engulf it, chop it off. Our antibodies are there, like if a virus, COVID is reaching in our body, like if an individual has good antibodies against COVID or any other influenza virus, it will neutralize it. So means what happens when a cell is transforming? The basic difference is like in the case of infectious diseases, the threat is coming from the outside. While in the case of cancer, the threat is developing inside our body itself. So since our immune system has to be controlled also, so that it does not attack our own healthy cells. So during the course of development, when we are developing from a one single pluripotent cell to a fetus and then to an individual, our immune cells, which are self-reactive to our own architecture, they get deleted. So that's why like most of the highly potent immune reactive cancer cells, anti-cancer cells, they are not there anymore. And since the tumor antigens are our own cells architecture express antigens, so most of these tumor antigens not get recognized by our own immune repertoire. So in the case of a tumor, let's take a step back in a sense of what happens in the case of immune editing and immune development phase. So when a normal tissue, like when we are seeing it gets transformed as a result of a mutation, there will be like some danger signals. So that's what I was saying, like when there is an immunogenic tumor that is developing, then these danger signals will attract immune cells, NK cells, T cells, B cells, and these cells and the macrophages, they will come and they will clear up this malignant cancer. But in the case, what happens is like in certain scenarios, some of the cancer cells can escape this immune onslaught. They can remain dormant for a longer time. And over the years, like over the, cancer is also considered as a disease of aged, because like our cells are dividing and during the course of cell division, there are some mutations happening. So over the course of the years, when there is a mutation load that crosses the threshold of this homeostasis, then that cell become a highly malignant tumor, and then it escapes the immune onslaught because it can also secrete these immunosuppressive factors. So these immunosuppressive factors, this not only creates a secluded environment for these cancer cells to grow, but they also make these immune cells ineffective. So this is the whole story. And how it happens, this is basically like this is called a tumor microenvironment. So there is a secluded environment that any tumor, solid tumor, creates, in which there are a plethora of cells which are reaching there, which in normal scenario are good immune cells. They are designed to function and means identify a threat and then neutralize that threat. But this tumor, when it is developing, this creates certain scenario that when these cells reach, they are adapted to its own benefit. So we'll be talking some of these cells, but like before that, let me give a brief introduction to what are the main immune escape mechanisms that a tumor deploys. One is it modulates its tumor immunogenicity. As I was saying, like when a tumor antigen is created as a result of a mutation, if you designed a one strategy, the tumor can lose that antigen. So this is called like tumor antigenic loss. So that when immune cells which have been generated against a particular tumor antigenic epitope, they are no longer functional. So that is how like a tumor can recur also. Like then, as I was saying, like these tumor cells, they can secrete interleukin 10, TGF-beta, co-inhibitory molecules. There is a HLA-G molecule, which is an immunosuppressive MSC molecule, which is going to neutralize the natural killer cells, which happens to kill all the cells which have lost MSC molecule expression. So this is the strategy. They can lose the expression of antigen. They can lose the expression of MSC molecules. And also they can secrete these immunosuppressive, not only like immunosuppressive cytokines, but also immunosuppressive abnormal MSC molecules like HLA-G. So which will create a, secluded environment where your functional immune cells will not be able to work. And then there is another hypothesis that tumor cells express these death receptor ligands so that when functional immune cells will reach, there is a death receptor signaling that will be launched by this tumor cells. And those functional immune cells will undergo cell death by programmed cell death or activation induced cell death. So I'll be talking about some of these strategies that we have developed, how we can overcome this immune suppression. What are the different requirements for a functional immune cell generation, and how we can overcome this immune suppressive microenvironment? So I'll be talking basically touching upon three key areas. I have a lot of slides for the data, but like I think I'll skip. I want to just give a message to the audience, and then maybe in the next time, we will talk one each in much more details and all those things. So if we are talking about different types of immunotherapy strategies, we can put them mostly in two broad categories. One is active specific vaccination, which is the cancer vaccines. So you have an individual which has developed a cancer, you take out immune cells or dendritic cells from that individual, then you can modify those dendritic cells by different means. For example, you can put the tumor antigen in there and it becomes a dendritic cell-based vaccine. So this has been approached. This was the initial approach that was tried. Although it didn't work, we will talk about it, how it didn't, why it didn't work. Then the next strategy is you can take a tumor lysate. You can take the tumor, make a lysate, so that all the tumor antigenic epitope load is there in that lysate. Then you pulse these cancer patient derived dendritic cells, and then it becomes a multivalent vaccine from that for that individual. Then another approach is you can take tumor cells directly. And only thing is that tumor cell is lacking. They have the tumor antigen, but they don't have necessary molecules by which they can induce a immune response. So you can gene modify tumor cells so that they become more immune stimulatory. So that becomes a tumor cell based vaccine, like a GM-CSF was initially tried. Ciprucel was the first cancer vaccine for that purpose. So apart from these tumor antigen specific dendritic cell vaccines, there is an approach that was synthetic peptide. So you have known tumeric antigenic epitopes. That antigenic epitopes were directly infused into the cancer patient with an idea that individuals or cancer patients' own dendritic cells will acquire that epitope and then prime that immune repertoire of that individual and generate a good immune response. So all these approaches were initial with the understanding that these are the approaches that work against infectious diseases. But like these approaches were not successful in the case of tumor. Why? Because one thing is there is an immunosuppressive microenvironment in the cancer patient. Another is, like as I said, like this individual do not have a highly functional immune repertoire against tumor antigenic epitopes. So the high avidity T cells are not existing there. So that is one of the limitations. So recently it has been found that there are positive signals, there are negative signals, which are essential for generating a good immune response. So a negative signal is called immune checkpoint, and positive signal is called co-stimulatory molecules. So immune checkpoint inhibitor blocking antibodies have been used, and they have produced a remarkable outcome in the lung cancer and several other cancers now. And this approach was a recipient of a Nobel Prize, as I think everybody is aware of. So this is the first Nobel Prize of many in the field of cancer immunotherapy. And this has not only provided a proof of principle for immunotherapy to be a viable approach, but this has also revived this DC-based vaccine or cancer vaccine approaches also. So there are a lot of combinatorial approaches that are being pursued, and several of them are under clinical trials. So we will be hearing about that. But I will be talking about another facet, that is adaptive immunotherapy. So as I said, individual doesn't have a good functional immune cells to begin with. So how to create them? Whatever approach you are doing, unless it is a BRAF inhibitor or something which works to a certain extent, but the tumor comes back up, there is a relapse, then again, we are at the same point, how to overcome the immune resist, means this tumor means relapse. So means how can we invigorate individual's immune response in spite of these challenges that they don't have a good functional immunity, immune cells? So you can engineer. So you can engineer, initially the approach was that you can just take the whole lymphocyte population, and then these were converted into lymphokine activated killer by co-culturing them with a high dose cytokines. So they acquire cytolytic potential, and that was administered to that individual. But since they were not specific to tumor antigen, there were a lot of side effects. So this approach didn't work very well. Another approach came at TIL, which is tumor infiltrating lymphocytes. So as I said, when there is a tumor microenvironment, immune cells are reaching there, but they are not functional anymore. So from this tumor mass, these functional CD4 T cells, CD8 T cells, they were cultured in the laboratory. They were cultured in a large number, and these cells were then administered to those cancer patients. And these have shown a proof of principle that TIL, when they are expanded and they are administered to the cancer patient, they can protect. More refined of this approach was you can generate a CTL clone out of these TIL, and that becomes a personalized immunotherapy. And the approach that I will be talking about is engineered anti-tumor T cells, whereby these T cells, which are recognizing a tumor antigen, they recognize by a receptor which they express, which is T cell receptor. Or now it has been created an artificial receptor, which is called chimeric antigen receptor. But in this talk, we'll be talking about T cell receptor, which is naturally expressed. So you can generate a T cell repertoire, which is individual specific for a tumor antigen. And then you can generate a clone, and you can isolate a T cell receptor. And once that TCR is there in your hand, then you can create a individual specific anti-tumor T cells. You just isolate T cells from this individual, engineer it with a retro or a lentiviral vector, which is expressing tumor antigenic epitope, a specific TCR, and then administer it back. So this approach is has also shown a lot of promise, and soon we will have some approvals in this scenario. So whether it is a cancer vaccine approach or whether it's an adaptive immunotherapy, there are three key cells which are essential in this immunotherapy approach, which is one is antigen presenting cell, second is CD8 positive T cells, and the third is CD4 positive T cells. The role of antigen presenting cells, as I discussed, they present antigen to CD8 and CD4 T cells. CD8 become killer cells, and CD4 can either become a helper or can become a suppressor. So means CD4 is a multifaceted means population, which not only is essential for the generation of a good immunity, but they can also bring it down. So we will be talking about the approach that we have developed. Like in a sense, if you want to generate a good immunity, you have to have a CD4 help. But what happens is, like if you are talking about a tumor site, then CD8 T cells, since all the cells which are in our body, they express MHC class 1 molecule. So whether it's a tumor cell, whether it's another cell, they are expressing MHC class 1 molecule. And if an antigenic epitope is presented, so this will get recognized by CD8 positive T cells. But if you want to incorporate these helper kind of a CD4 T cells, because they will provide help to these CD8 T cells, and not only help in the they are sustaining their life, but also proliferating them in a much greater number and helping them to acquire potent cytolytic function. So you need the CD4 help, but since these tumor cells do not express this MHC class 2 molecules, so it is very difficult to engage CD4 help in this tumor setting. So we wanted to develop an approach. So this is exactly what I've just said, you want CD4 help, but since most of the tumor cells don't express this MHC class 2 molecule, so it is very difficult to engage. So the approach that we developed was can we just overcome the natural course of development of a CD4 T cells? Can we educate CD4 T cells to talk to tumor cells in a MHC class 1 restricted manner? But the problem there is, as I said, CD4 T cells, they can help, they can also become suppressors or a regulator. So if you make them talk in a class 1 manner, they can attack the tumor site in a class 1 manner. But if they become regulated, they will negatively impact this CD8 even. So we wanted to see, if we create these CD4 T cells, can we make them talk in a class 1 manner, and can they also become helper in a nature? So that was our working hypothesis, that how to create a helper CD4 T cells which will function in a MHC class 1 restricted manner. So our experimental approach was, we took a high avidity TCR from a CD8 positive T cells, and then we cloned it in a lentiviral vector and then put it on both CD4 and CD8 T cells. And we tested whether this CD8 T cells, we anticipated this will acquire lytic function and anti-tumor function, but what happens to this? So I'll be sharing a little bit about the biology of these CD4 T cells, that how we were able to generate this helper as well as killer CD4 T cells. And as I was talking, another approach that was a tumor attack, counter attack, which is immune cells can be killed by tumor cells by means of engagement with the death receptor ligands. So we wanted to create T cells which will withstand not only programmed cell death or tumor mediated death, but their own inherent programmed cell death pathways. So because as I said, not naturally primary T cells, they have a shelf life of a certain period, but we wanted to make them live a little bit longer. So let's see how we created these engineered anti-tumor T cells. So this is usually, let me tell you, in the beginning, as I said, means that we have a very low number of high avidity anti-tumor T cells in our body for any given antigenic epitope which is associated with cancer. But in some individuals, there can be expansion. So here is one example, cancer patient which was being seen at UCLA. He was undergoing treatment. So he had almost 7% of population of tumor reactive CD8 T cells. And you can say, imagine 7% CD8 T cells which are tumor reactive, but that individual still had the tumor. So the basic reason for that is those immunosuppressive microenvironment and tumor immune escape mechanisms. So from there we isolated. So all these T cells, they are expressing individual, although they are all specific to MART1, epitope is same, but TCR is different. So we wanted to generate a T cell clone. So we generated a T cell clone from one single cell. So we did a dilutional assay, and that's how we generated a single cell clone. And from this one single clone, we isolated two functional TCRs. First, we tested in the jerkard. Then once we were able to express tetramer positive T cells with this transduced jerkard cells, then we cloned those chains, alpha and beta chains, into a lentiviral vector, third generation lentiviral vector. And then we checked the transduction ability of these jerkard cells. So this showed that our vector was very efficient in transducing these jerkard cell line. And we then moved to human primary CD4 T cells. So I'm just going to show like work on CD4 T-cells, because the objective that I'm sharing with you guys is how we can create helper cells. Although we did work parallelly with the engineered CD8 T-cells also. So in the interest of the time, I'll be sharing some of the data on engineered CD4 cells. So these cells were generated. Then the next thing was like, are they functional? So how do you test the function? So you show them the antigen. So we use the cells which are not expressing any antigen naturally. So this is a natural which has no antigen. This is a right antigen, which is a dark one and the dark black. And then you have to have a proper control. Since there are students also, so I must say like whenever you are doing experiment, you have to have a positive control, you have to have a negative control. Without that, it doesn't work. And any experiment that you are doing, you have to have replicates, because then only you can put a statistical analysis over there. Otherwise, a reviewer will just trash your work when you go for publication. So whenever the antigen was shown, then only there is a production of cytokines. And what kind of a cytokine? These are Th1 kind of a cytokine, interferon gamma and IL-2. And when we are talking about Th2 or immunosuppressive kind of cytokine, which are IL-4 and IL-10, they were not produced. So this was an indication that they are producing Th1 bias cytokine response, and we reproduce it with multiple individuals. And then we went on to see like whether the same response is being seen against the tumor cells or not. So the first objective was whether they recognize the tumor cells or not. So we had different cell lines, A375, which naturally does not express the tumor antigen. The one we engineered a tumor cell line to express a tumor antigen, MART1. And then one tumor cell line, which was naturally expressing tumor antigen, and another tumor antigen line, which was not expressing. So whenever this peptide epitope was put in, this was recognized. And the cells which have been engineered or which are naturally expressing this tumor epitope, they get recognized. So this was tumor means antigen specific. The recognition and the response was antigen specific. So these are, and as a control, we use these CD8 T cells. So in the D, we use CD8 population as a positive control. So this is again like what kind of a response is there. So we found just a Th1 bias response against tumor antigenic epitope, interferon gamma, IL-2, but no IL-10. So this gives us confidence that our cell population is Th1 biased. And then we one term that I used was the avidity. So this talks about competence of a T cell to kill a particular target at a very low dose of antigen or a very low number. So we did this dose kinetic analysis of antigenic epitope using CD8 positive T cell as a control. And we came to the conclusion that our TCR was of a very high avidity, like in the sense as less as 1:10 target to effector ratio, it was very effective, as was CD8 positive T cells in there. And at a very low dose of antigenic epitope. So the next thing was like, okay, you can produce a cytokine response, but since natural T cells, CD8 T cells, which are expressing this class 1 receptor, they kill. So means we posed another hypothesis. Can we make CD4 T cells to kill, which naturally does not kill their target? So we were quite surprised to see like this is a cell line again, which is naturally not expressing a tumor antigenic epitope, but we pulse it with the control or a right peptide. M1 is the right peptide and M3 is a wrong antigenic epitope. So whenever there is a right antigenic epitope shown, so these cells were efficiently lysed. Means our CD4 T cells not only were able to express Th1 cytokine response, but they were also able to kill the target. And then we tested it against the tumor cells also, and it was exhibiting the cytolytic ability against tumor cells also. And at the bottom, these are control. As I said, every experiment has to have a control. So as a control, we use the CD8 positive T cells, which were engineered with the same antigenic epitope specific TCR. Now, next thing is like whether the killing is a classical granzyme perforin mediated process as a natural CTL kill or not. So we looked at the expression of granzyme and perforin in our engineered population. So what happens is like when these activated T cells, they come in contact with their target, which is expressing that antigenic epitope, they will release these granules. And these granules will enter the target cells and they will chop off the DNA and then kill the target. So means when we expose these cells to a target which is expressing this right kind of antigen, this degranulation happened. So that means the killing was mediated by this granzyme and perforin, and they were means efficiently able to release these granules. And if we block this degranulation process by blocking it with the EGTA, or we block means binding of this T cells with the target, because the binding is through MSC class 1 molecule, so we use anti-MSC class 1 antibody. So once this binding is interfered, then the killing is also interfered. If you block this degranulation process, killing is interfered. So means the killing is happening in the MSC class 1 manner, and it is mediated in by degranulation or granzyme and perforin. So the next thing is like, okay, you have identified a particular functional TCR, which is Th1 biased, and it can kill also. But is it a rule or is it an exception? Can you reproduce this work with a different kind of a TCR? So we identified another TCR that was we were provided essentially from a very stalwart of the field, Dr. Steve Rosenberg, who is working at NCI, and hopefully in the next couple of years he will be the alongside Carl June. If he is not, after that he will definitely be one of the leader to receive Nobel. So he's essentially you can say like a pioneer in the cancer immunotherapy field. So we were provided another receptor which was having much more high transduction ability, and we were able to generate almost a clonal line of these engineered T cells. So then we showed that once you show this right kind of antigen, these T cells start proliferating in an antigen specific manner. When this is a wrong antigen or something, then the proliferation is very low, division is very less. But when you see the right antigen, then these T cells divide much more efficiently. And this TCR also is Th1 biased. IL-2 is there, interferon gamma is there, TNF-alpha is there, but no or very little IL-10 or IL-4. So then we got another TCL receptor, which has a much higher transduction ability. Then we wanted to see like, okay, they're producing cytokine, they can kill, but like the, if they're producing cytokine, can they provide the, help in a real term or not? When we talk about a real term help, that means they have to facilitate a better immune response generation. So this is a, in a culture, we cultured dendritic cells with a peptide pulsed, and then we put donor-derived CD8 positive T cells, and we kept in the culture for 10 to 15 days, and then we look for it like how many T cells are generated against that particular epitope. So if we have nothing there, CD4 T cells or something like that, then 1.3% of antigen specific T cells were generated. But when we incorporated this helper T cells in this co-culture setting, then almost like 25 fold expansion fold increase in the generation of this magnitude of this response was observed. So there are three different donors in which we are, later on we went on to do in many more, but I'm showing of initial data, like we could see like significant increase in the magnitude of the response that was generated by incorporation of these class 1 restricted helper cells. So this slide essentially summarizes the first part of the talk, that is, you can create something which is not a non-existence in the physiology, which is MSC class 1 restricted CD4 T cells, which can not only like provide help to CD8 T cells for generation of a robust CTL response, but they can also exhibit cytolytic response of their own. So these are some of the papers in which we reported these findings, and a couple review articles also. So then the next approach that I was talking about, that tumor essentially uses this counterattack approach. And we wanted to keep these cells live longer. So we wanted to, our basic hypothesis was like, you are expanding the T cells outside the body of an individual and then putting it back into that individual's body. So once they go in there, then programmed cell death is the natural phenomena, and activation-induced cell death is a natural phenomenon. What is activation-induced cell death? When you activate T cells above a threshold, they acquire their effector function. But when they see the antigen for the second time, a significant fraction of those T cells will undergo cell death. So they will exhibit the function, but they will undergo cell death. So means that is called contraction also during the course of immune response. But when you are doing adaptive immunotherapy and a significant fraction of the T cells when you are administering into the individual, if they undergo cell death, even before removing the tumor load, then that therapy is not going to work. So we wanted to make cells which can withstand this AICD and PCD. The idea is this blue line, which is they will sustain longer. The magnitude of the response will be greater. This will last long. And then eventually, once it will contract, there is a phenomenon called T cell memory. So our vaccines work because like we have a memory against the polio antigen. So whenever there is a virus approaching by a hook or a crook, our memory cells against the polio virus will kill it. So the same approach means if we are generating these cells in a larger number, there will be a better memory, and then that will be able to take care of the tumor, relapsing tumor. So with that hypothesis, we started working another line of work that was going on in that along that time of engineered T cells. That was what is the mechanism of the T cell death. So this is the example, like this is not engineered T cells, but like this is the initial precursor frequency that I was talking about. They are very less in the number. An individual has just 0.07% or 0.05% for a one particular antigenic epitope. And then when we culture with the highly immunogenic dendritic cells, we can generate like almost like 18% population against tumor antigenic epitope. But activation induced cell death is once these cells are generated, when you show them the right kind of antigen again, a significant fraction is undergoing cell death. So this is called activation induced cell death. So then once we establish that we have a model whereby AICD is, can be studied, are they dying through death receptors or there is a different mechanism? So we looked at blocking antibodies or inhibitors against all these death receptor molecules, FAS, TRAIL, IFNFRC, NFFRC. So these were all used. So this is like what we are looking at is viable cells. Means antigen specific, which is tetramer positive cells, but annexin negative. When T cells is undergoing cell death, they start expressing phosphatidylserine on their surface. Annexin has the affinity for phosphatidylserine. So if you can tag this annexin with a dye, fluorescent dye, so then it will bind to the cells which are undergoing cell death. And then you can measure it by this fluorescence. So this is the assay that we use. So we use this. In this case, we are looking at tetramer positive means antigen specific, but annexin negative means viable cells. So the control is 100%, wrong peptide, wrong antigenic epitope, almost like 95% are viable. But when you show the right antigen, almost like 55% cells are undergoing cell death. And when you block all these different death receptor molecules, it doesn't protect it. So in summary, like this is like that death receptors were not working. And all these death receptors, the downstream molecule is activation of caspases, caspase 8, and then caspase 3, caspase 9. So there are different caspases, like which eventually means caspase 8 or caspase 9, they eventually culminate to caspase 3. So we looked at activation of this caspase 3. We were not able to see activation of caspase 3 in this CTL population. But when we induce a caspase mediated death by staurosporin, then this caspase 3 was activated. So we used all the controls that this death was not happening through caspases and death receptors were not involved. So we searched a lot of pharmacological inhibitors, and then we identified one JNK inhibitor, SP600125. So this was able to protect a significant fraction of these T cells from undergoing AICD. And then we looked at the means activation of JNK and its downstream molecule P-Cjun. Cjun was phosphorylated. So we concluded that that JNK was involved in this. Then as our work on engineered anti-tumor T cells picked up, then we wanted to see like, okay, natural T cells were dying through this death receptor mediated independent and caspase independent death. Are these engineered anti-tumor T cells following the same path or not? So we did the same assay, and just let's look at the bottom most of these graphs only. So these cells are also undergoing cell death, and they are undergoing death in an antigen specific manner. So means another means readout we used was DLC6. So if the students are interested, once the T cells is undergoing death, then mitochondria actually loses its voltage potential. And you can measure it by a fluorescent dye. DiOC6 binds, and if there is a fluorescent tag to it, then you can measure. So if you see, like in this where my cursor is, all the cells are means in this right and cohort. If you are seeing the upper right cohort, they are antigen specific. Lower cohort, they are antigen non-specific. So when you see the right antigen, then there is a shift towards the left. So this means like there is a lesser of a voltage potential of these T cells, which is called hypopolarization. So once these T cells undergo cell death, mitochondria undergoes hypopolarization. So we use not only annexin, but mitochondria hypopolarization and establish both CD4 and CD8 engineered T cells, one undergoing antigen specific T cell death. This is a very interesting difference that we found, that when we are talking about these engineered CD4 T cells, when they see the antigen for the first time, they don't undergo cell death. But when they see the antigen for the second time, they undergo cell death. While in the case of engineered CD8 T cells, I remind you that CD8 naturally express class 1 restricted TCR. So even on the first exposure, they are susceptible. So there is a differential strength, which is providing this differential susceptibility to AICD. So that means this is offering one of the areas where I'm very much interested in exploring further by bioinformatics means, how we can identify the molecules which are making these two population differentially susceptible to AICD, and that will lead to a lot of new discoveries, I believe. So again, like this slide, I'm not gonna go in detail, but we established that death receptors were not involved in the engineered CD4, CD8 T cells, and then JNK was involved in this. So this is the same that we have already established, but we proved it again in the case of engineered CD4 and CD8. And JNK was mediating this death in engineered T cells also. So now the death receptors are not involved. Cells are undergoing death. JNK is involved, but like what is, if it is caspase independent, where it is coming from? So then we came across like mitochondria has not only caspase mediated death mediators, but caspase independent death executioners, for example, apoptosis inducing factor and endogene. So we looked at all these different molecules, whether they are being released from the mitochondria or not. So by cell fractionation analysis, we found that usually this is the understanding that whenever there is a cell death, then cytochrome C is a smaller molecule, it will get released. But we found that there is a differential release of caspase independent death executioner, which is apoptosis inducing factor. And cytochrome C, which triggers caspase activation also, this was not being released. And so this was the main culprit here for T cell death. And as a control, we use HSP60, which is, resides in the mitochondria. So that like it is not a, we already had a means positive control for a mitochondrial permeability like breach or something like that. We did microscopy also. So if you see on the top, the AIF is located in this mitochondria, which is usually goes at the periphery only of these T cells. And we stain the nucleus with the cytox green dye. So this mitochondria resident AIF and cytox green nucleus, they are very separate, but when they undergo death, this AIF gets released, and then this death happens. And one of the features of this AIF mediated death is this chops up the DNA at a very large fragment size, almost in a 50 kb range. So we did the pulse field gel electrophoresis, whereby we separated these 50 kilobase pair strands, and then we were able to see like there is a large scale DNA degradation in this. And in the case of caspase mediated death, there is a smaller ladder which was induced by star scoring. And these single stranded nicks were created by this apoptosis inducing factor. So there was a lot of nicks in the cells which are undergoing death, and we could also locate this AIF there. So the basic means we came down to mitochondria and JNK involved, but what else is happening? So then we came across there is a means P53 has a role in caspase dependent death also, but recently there was another side of P53 that was identified, which was caspase means this non-transcription mediated pathway of P53. So we wanted to see like whether this means non-transcription dependent pathway of p53 is involved in this AICD or not. So we use an inhibitor against this p53. Is there a question? Okay, so we use this p53 inhibitor, and then we found that whenever we use this p53 inhibitor, then AICD can be blocked. As you see, like in this T2 plus M1, you have almost like 61.4% cells. Okay, so we are seeing So 61.4% T cells are undergoing cell death. And in increasing concentration of this p53 inhibitor, this blocks this death, and 20 micromolar concentration, we could almost block 80% of this cell death in there. So this was also playing role in there. And then next thing was p53 involved. Then what is happening to this pro-apoptotic and anti-apoptotic proteins? So one of the pro-apoptotic protein is BIM. This has a critical role in cell-mediated death and everything. So we wanted to see like whether this is involved in this or not, T cell death. So in naturally, like BIM is present in the cytosol, but T cells, when they are undergoing cell death, this BIM translocates to the mitochondria. So if you see these speckles, they are all spread out in the cytosolic region. But like when and there is very little on the sides. But when a T cell is dying, there is a significant translocation of BIM to the mitochondria. And then later on, we were also able to see like this BIM, which is present into this mitochondria, this also coincides with the GNK. So GNK and BIM are present into the mitochondria, and then they are controlling the mitochondrial permeability. But how they are controlling it? So we identified that GNK was actually also interacting directly with the VDAC channel in the mitochondria. So once a T cell gets the signal, this goes to the GNK, and BIM also translocates to the mitochondria, and they interact with the VDAC, and then VDAC gates are open. And then this is how like this apoptosis inducing factor selectively gets released into the nucleus. In the cytosol, then goes to the nucleus, and then it causes these large scale DNA degradation. So these are some of the papers that in which we reported these studies. So I think we are pretty much late, but like I will just tell one more story and then run through like some of the third part that I was talking about. So because this is very dear to me, and I think the audience will be very much interested in knowing it, like so how you can improve the immunogenicity of dendritic cells. And this is at the heart of like what is the immune escape mechanisms, like, and how you can overcome this. So what is dendritic cells? Dendritic cells are the best antigen presenting cells in our body. They are the master regulators of immunity. Dendritic cell progenitor or a monocyte, this will develop into immature dendritic cells. They express certain molecules. But once they encounter like infectious disease agents or some other stimulating factors, they undergo like maturation. They acquire like antigen processing capability, antigen presentation capability. So that's what is important for a proper presentation. So there are three key signals which dendritic cells provides to the T cells. First is the antigen, which comes by this MSC bound antigen, which is recognized by T cell receptor by the T cells. Second is this co-stimulatory or co-inhibitory molecules, which provides either an acceleration or a break. So this first signal is this T cell MSC and peptide, TCR. And then the second is this co-stimulatory molecule, which will trigger, move the car up. And the third signal is growth factor, cytokines, which will essentially like make the car run even much more faster. So this thing, this slide, I think we will discuss more in detail in some other day, but as we were talking, MSC class 1 and class 2 pathway, so endogenous antigens which are expressed in the cell or dendritic cells, they are processed through MSC class 1 pathway and presented to CD8 T cells. Exogenously acquired antigenic epitopes, they are processed through MSC class 2 pathway and they are presented to CD4 T cells. and those CD4s and CD8 acquire lytic function or helper and a regulator function. So how these dendritic cells means if we are culturing the cells in the dish, then you can control the environment. But what happens in the physiology? So in the physiology, like whenever there is an infectious agent or like RNA, DNA, whatever of these foreign pathogens, they come in contact with this dendritic cells. These are called danger-associated molecular patterns. These DCs or their precursors, they undergo maturation. And once they undergo maturation, the microenvironment they are in, if they encounter IL-10 and TGF-beta, this will remain a immature DC or become a tolerogenic DC. If they encounter like IL-12 and interferon gamma, this will become immunogenic DC. So these immunogenic DCs are highly functional to generate a good immune response. And if they encounter like CD4 T cells, this will form TH1 type of a CD4. And if these are tolerogenic, then they will form like these regulatory T cells. And if they form like these IL-4, if they come in contact with IL-4, they form TH2 type of CD4 T cells. So there are different types of cells that are generated. So in the innate immunity, these cells are also responsible for phagocytosis of the pathogen. So means initially it was thought like innate pathway is separate, adaptive pathway is separate, but now we know like they are very much connected. And in this dendritic cell actually serves as a bridge between innate and adaptive pathways. So this is a immature DC, which has not encountered the epitope or the pathogen, and they have the antigen uptake or phagocytic ability. They can process the antigen, but they cannot efficiently present the antigen. Once they encounter these damp molecules and the accessory factors, they undergo maturation, and that's when they can efficiently present. They have a costimulatory molecule which can induce a T cell activation. So this is essential for a good immunity generation. And this immature DC or a tolerogenic DC, they are essentially responsible for tolerance, but you need tolerance also because like anybody has some member in a family like who have like rheumatoid arthritis or something. So that is because self-reactive T cells are creating problem. So if you can incorporate these tolerogenic cells, then that is a therapy for them. So this I'm not gonna do much in detail. These are positive and negative signals that are caught. And this is essentially the same. If you have a good mature cells, you will have a good expansion of the T cells. If you are tolerogenic, no response. And this is that counterattack hypothesis. That is, if you are T cells encounter a fast expressing cell, then they undergo cell death. And if you see, like this is just a slide that I've taken from a published work. So immature DC, they look like this patent population. And mature one, they acquire more of a dendrites. Their expansion of or expression of these costimulatory molecule gets much greater, and then these expansion of the T cells is much greater. So we wanted to see like whether we can create improve the immunogenic potential of dendritic cells or not. This was in the early days of my work. So bear with me the quality and primitive nature of this work. But like I wanted to show that this is indeed doable with cutting edge latest technology also. So this is like we wanted to use siRNA for knocking down some of the immunosuppressive factors. So first we wanted to see whether siRNA is being delivered also or not. So we used GFP specific siRNA and knocked down that GFP signal in there. And then we confirmed this DC with their postulated molecule expression. And so in a dose dependent manner, we could knock down the GFP signal by siRNA, then we moved on to IL-10 knockdown. So this is the control where there's a IL-10 expression is there, and we could essentially knock down IL-10 with siRNA. And once you knock down siRNA, IL-10 means expression, then IL-12 was induced. As I was talking to you, like if there is a positive kind of a cytokine, that induces the immunogenic potential of dendritic cells. IL-12 is one of that. So if you knock down IL-10, IL-12 goes up. And then we found that a little bit of costimulatory molecule expression was also going up. In the pink, there is a mature DC, and in the blue is siRNA. So very slight increase in the costimulatory molecule expression. But there was significant increase in the magnitude of the response that were able to generate. For example, at the baseline, almost 0.1%. But when you see like mature DC, means if there is a immature culture, as I was showing, if there is a mature DC, it will not present the antigenic epitope very well. So this slide essentially captures that phenomena also. Immature DCs are not good stimulators of immune response. But when you use a mature DC, then there is a good expansion. And if you knock down those negative signals, then the magnitude is more and they produce more cytokine. They can also kill more. So this we established that you can induce the immunogenic potential of dendritic cells by knocking down negative signals. And another thing that we were talking about, these engineered T cells. So can these CD4 T cells that we were talking, like they are helping these expansion of the CD8 T cells, can they also act on the dendritic cells and neutralize this regulatory T cells mediated immune suppression? So this, I'll take a couple slides and then probably we'll wrap up after that. So in this case, like what we have shown is like this, if we just focus on the C part itself, rather than going through this cumbersome one. So when you have generated a IVC without any incorporation of CD4 help, the magnitude of the response is less. When you incorporate these helpers population that we created, magnitude was significantly higher. These are the real actual numbers, not percentage. So when you use control CD4, then this is increased slightly because there is a phenomena called DC licensing. Licensing, what does that mean? CD4 T cells will act onto the dendritic cells through CD40 ligand engagement, and this will improve the immunogenicity of that. So that's how we are seeing that CD4 control was able to license to certain extent. But when you have antigen specific CD4 T cells, then they are doing much more greater licensing and also help to the CD8 T cells. When you incorporate regulatory T cells in there, especially induced regulatory T cells, then this whole expansion is next to nothing. But incorporate CD4 control along with that, it is not alleviated. But when you incorporate these CD4 helper cells along with this regulatory T cells, then this whole break that has been induced by these regulatory T cells, this is removed. So essentially, like these cells were able to not only help the magnitude, but they were also mitigate the regulatory T cells mediated suppression of this expansion. So now the next thing is like, what is the mechanism? Do the contact is required or not? So we address that phenomena also. So, but I will just, you can take my word on that, that we established that the contact was needed. And then these cells were able to improve the immunogenicity potential of these dendritic cells. And as I was showing in the case of IL-10 knockdown, there was much more greater IL-12 production by these CD4 T cells, engineered CD4 T cells, co-cultured dendritic cells. So essentially, like you can improve the immunogenicity of dendritic cells by knocking down the immunosuppressive factors, which are inherent to that dendritic cell population, or by incorporating some of these exogenous factors like our engineered T cells. So our engineered T cells is multi faceted. It can produce helper cytokine, it can kill also, it can boost the magnitude of CD8 T cells, and it can also negate the regulatory T cells mediated immune suppression. So these are the regulatory T cells mediated suppressive strategies, and I think I've discussed them in detail, so we don't have to discuss it much more later in detail. But in the last part, like I will just run through one more important phenomena or area that I'm working on, which is like you can generate dendritic cells from an individual, from a cancer patient. But the basic limitation there is if an individual has an immunosuppressive microenvironment, so there is a phenomena called epigenetics. So means that microenvironment will essentially affect the inherent makeup of that or epigenetic profile of those cells. And if they are skewed to our tolerance or suppression, they will not be a good inducer, whether you make a cancer vaccine or whether you do adaptive therapy. So we wanted to create cells which are naive in the nature. They have never been born And then if you, they have never been born, they have not encountered immunosuppressive microenvironment. So you can generate a good immune response. So with that hypothesis, we wanted to generate these stem cells, stem cell lines, and then generate immune cells. So it means I'll just share the work only like in that. So this work just summarizes like how we generated iPSC from human blood-derived cells. So we use the Sendai virus. So this first we confirmed that we were able to transduce these cells. And then once these reprogramming factors, which are OCT4, SOX2, LIN28, CIMIC, they were introduced, then we were able to generate donor-specific iPSC lines. So means I've shown you the cartoon of a dendritic cell, how it was looking like a dendrites, but this is actual iPSC line, how it looks like. This is a primitive clone of an iPSC line. So we generated from several individuals, iPSC clones, and then we characterized their pluripotency profile, that they are pluripotent in the nature. And then we have addressed this bulk of immunogenicity. So one of the limitation was like, means when I was starting to work on this, there was a hypothesis like stem cells and themselves are immunosuppressive in the nature. So if they are immunosuppressive in the nature, like means that they are inherently, then the work came actually like some of the people were saying like, means immunogenicity of induced pluripotent stem cells or non-immunogenicity. So the basic idea is if stem cells are inherently immunogenic, which was shown in mouse models, then whatever you generate from them, my individual means my body's iPSC, if I have generated and they are inherently immunogenic, and then I administer back to me, then my cells will recognize them as immunogenic and like they will be chopped up. And then that therapy will not work. So although like I'm not giving a good example that that will be autologous system, but like initially when we were talking about the work that was with the HSC, so which was an allogenic phenomena. So we wanted to establish what happens to these innate and adaptive pathways of dendritic cells when you generate iPSC. So we did quite a bit of work in there, TLR and antigen processing pathways. So this slide summarizes that dendritic cells have class 1, class 2 pathway, and also TLR pathway for innate immune response development. But when you generate iPSC from there, both innate and also adaptive immune mechanism go silent. And only this, since they express MHC class 1 molecule, they can present the antigenic epitope. So we essentially established that human iPSC lines, which are generated from most functional professional antigen presenting cells, they go immunologically silent when they are in a they are de-differentiated into iPSC. So then we also re-differentiated into functional antigen presenting cells. So these are on the left hand side, these are antigen presenting cells which have been generated from these iPSC line. On the right hand side are the blood derived dendritic cells. One of the key properties, as I said, like they can phagocytose. So we did this bead phagocytosis assay. So they had the phagocytic ability. And then we also did like antigen peptide presentation assay, and they were also able to present the antigenic peptide in there. So this is essentially like, means we are working in the stem cell area also. We have generated functional immune cells, but like we have done some work on T cell generation also. And that work is still unpublished, and we are in the process of finishing up that work and then going for that. So in summary, I'll just say like that means you can generate an immune response by not only through natural phenomena by using dendritic cell pulse, antigen pulse dendritic cells, but you can also engineer with the TCR. We are also working on creating chimeric antigen receptor, so you can create CAR T cells. So we did have some conversation on this with Das sir. And then I'm very pleased that we will be working something along that line in the future. And then these are some of the work that we have developed here, like nano-based. So one, I'm pleased to just share that because this has been patented also, and our first very first manuscript had been published also. So this can also, not only we are using it for skin rejuvenation, but basic idea is we can use it for immunomodulatory abilities and all those things. and we can derive or means this means you want to deliver a tumor antigen, so you can deliver a tumor antigen through the skin also. So that is our holistic approach that we would like to develop certain means nano-based antigen delivery tools and all those things. We are also working in these face masks. And very pleased at the Innovation Day, or means we have received a support from MIT Information Center for this, taking this to a production and all this. And so with that, I really appreciate the time and all the opportunity that Dhruv and Das sir and Selvamurthy sir has given me. And I look forward to interacting with much more colleagues, and then find how we can collaborate in so many other ways that I've not thought of yet. And these are my earlier collaborators from my earlier institution. So with that, like I will just close my talk, and then if we have questions, so we can take some questions. I hope I was not keeping everybody like too late from the dinner or something.
Sir, thank you very much for a very extensive and comprehensive data presentation and the lecture. So that was very informative for, you know, the cancer immunology point of view. And you have discussed very well how one can engineer immune cells, okay, to fight against cancer. Now, there are several questions from the audience side. The first question, Dr. Manoj Garg is an associate professor and Ramalinga Swami Fellow at MIT Institute of Molecular Medicine and Stem Cell Research, AUP Noida. So he said, thank you very much. Interesting and knowledgeable talk. One small query. Did you challenge the tumors with your TCR engineered CD4 and CD8 positive cells in immunocompromised mice?
Yes. So that work was done by our collaborator. As I said, some of our collaborators at UCLA, Tony Ribas, who is now president of ACR. So means this was very much done. A challenge was done. Their homing to the tumor site was done. Their in vivo efficacy was done. And then second TCR that I showed to you, that already is in clinical trial. So animal work was done, and that paper came out in 2010 in PNS.
Okay. The second point that the same Dr. Manoj Garg has asked, could you please shed some lights on the possibilities of CAR T cells in solid tumor?
As I was talking about, one of the limitation in the tumor biology is identification of tumor specific antigen. So if you have a tumor associated antigen, then that will have a more of a side effect. So the greater challenge is how you can identify a tumor specific antigen. So there are different approaches that are being pursued. Some of the approaches include even MSC peptide complex specific CAR T, which will be just recognizing the mutagenic epitope, which is bound to the MSC. So means there are different approaches that are ongoing. We are also working on approaches. And then definitely B cell malignancy specific CAR T has worked. And because you can get rid of all the B cells and they will later on can come back up. But when we are talking about CAR T side, taking care of the side effect is the challenge. But we have to have innovative approaches to overcome those side effects. But it is indeed possible.
Okay. So another question is from Dr. Rupinder Bali. The question is how to keep immune system healthy to prevent cancer disease?
Okay. So means if you keep your food non-inflammatory, that is one. And means immune system gets screwed, whatever we are putting in our body. Apart from we don't have a control of whatever is getting in our body through air we are breathing and some of the infectious agents that are getting access to. But what is in our control is we take a non-inflammatory diet or something. So I think there is a very good field which is developing of nutraceuticals and nutraceutical modulation of epigenetics. Everything that we eat is going to affect the genetic makeup in terms of the epigenetic profile of our cells and also the immune cells. So if we keep our diet towards a non-inflammatory cohort, then that will help keep our immune cells and also body healthy.
Sir, another question is, what is best one, engineered CAR T cells or engineered TCR cells?
Since I was working on engineered TCR, so I'll say TCR, but no. This all depends what kind of a tumor you are talking about. So as I said, in the case of B-cell lymphoma, you can get rid of the cell population. There is a very little side effect that you will encounter. You can always get back the normal cells once the tumor is gone, tumor load is gone. So this has its own benefit. Excellent results in clinical trials. No doubt about it. And Carl June may be getting a Nobel very soon. But when we are talking about Dr. Manoj Garg's question is basically answers to that. I personally think against solid tumors, it will be a challenge to make CAR T unless we overcome those side effect things MSC peptide complex specific CAR T is one approach. But again, tumor may employ immune escape strategy by losing that particular epitope itself. So that becomes another challenge there. So both the approaches have their merit. CAR T has gotten into limelight first, but over the longer duration, TCR will pick up and they will both go hand in hand.
Okay, so I guess there is no more question now. So with this, if any one of you have any other questions and if you want to interact with Dr. Arvind Sabra personally, you can write him an email. You can get his email ID from the MIT website or from the cluster group. So with this, I would like to express my sincere thanks, sir, so that you have delivered such a wonderful lecture today on immune cells. Okay. Yeah. The email ID is asabra@ggn.mit.edu. So in case of any collaboration, any personal discussion on the project or anything that if you would like to discuss with, the speaker, you can contact him personally. Yeah. So with this, I would like to express my sincere thanks on behalf of Cancer Biology Cluster and the MIT University. So thank you. Thank you very much. And I also would like to thank Dr. B.C. Das, sir. Sir is very busy, but he has taken out, his precious time for this webinar. So thank you, sir. And I would like to thank all the participants, those who have participated in this webinar, for their active participation. So thank you very much, sir. And with this, we'll stop this session.
Thank you very much, Dhruv. Thank you very much, Das, sir. Appreciate it. I look forward.